just have to figure out, because all those are questions for them.
So I think now we can see the...
Oh, it's 8 o'clock. Prof. Ng is not here yet.
On YouTube.
Professor Ng is not here yet.
Professor Ng will over the streaming yacht or only through the YouTube?
Oh, so you are introducing me or I introduce myself. I'm happy with that. It's okay.
Oh, I can introduce. I prepare something introducing
you. Okay.
So it's time to start?
Yeah, let me go. And
yes, it's time to start. But so far, it seems like we only have 3 audience. Maybe we could wait
to
10 audience. Then we have a warm welcome.
But now it's 5 audience.
Oh, there is a lag on YouTube.
Yes, exactly.
Now I understand your lag. Oh, can they hear us? Not yet, right? We are still in the back room, right?
Yes, I think YouTube is still lagging because I cannot see the broadcast. Why? It's interesting.
You can see the broadcast? What did you mean?
It's okay now.
Okay.
That's not me, right?
Okay. So now it's a 10 watching. So let's start our meeting today. Good evening, everyone. Before we start our talking section, I would like to thank you all of our audience for attending today's meeting. So, before introduce our speaker, I would like to give you a brief introduction about ourselves. We hope more and more people can know who we are. So actually, we are a global team of medical physicists and teams from the leadership and mentoring program. The Leadership Mentoring Program organized by Professor Ng Huang Hong. And we organize a meeting monthly with various topics that aim to encourage young medical physicists to grow as future leaders, which can help the mentoring system in medical physicists. So if you want to know more about us, you can easily find our webpage or Facebook, Instagram from our YouTube channel. So please use like this video and subscribe our channel. You won't miss our upcoming webinars. Okay, let's get started. Welcome today's speaker, Dr. Evelyn Ho. She is a clinical radiologist, currently practicing in ParkCity Medical Centre, Kuala Lumpur. Dr. Evelyn is also the president-elect of Asian Oceania Society of Radiology and the chair of the RSNA's Regional Committee for Asian or Oceania. It's really impressive. Dr. Ho is over 20 years contribution to healthcare and community in Malaysia and worldwide. So it's such a great honor to have Dr. Emily Ho here. Today she's going to talk about an interesting and important topic. So today's topic is sometimes the world needs a crisis. Before our talking section, I would like to let you know that Dr. Evelyn Ho is very considerate and nice person. She wants to give us what we really want to know. So please, the audience, feel free to leave any questions and comments in the chat room on YouTube page during the speech. And I will let her know as soon as possible. She can give us more specific advice based on our question. That would be have a greater interaction with Dr. Ho. So let's welcome our today's speaker, Dr. Emily Ho. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. I actually want to have an icebreaker, and I would like all of you to type in. I see Frimayo from Brazil and Ms. Vargas. Good evening, good morning, and I guess anytime. Now, I have some pictures here to kind of like break the ice. So I have the topic of sometimes the world needs a crisis because I want to highlight that challenges are opportunities. And this slide is particularly busy because it invokes that kind of unease that everybody feels in a crisis. So here is some quiz, and if you can answer, just type it in, and maybe when Professor Ng joins us, he may be able to tell you. So who is this lady here? It's from your community. I will tell you the answer later. This is, of course, a bust, a statue of Marie Sklodowska. And what is this I'm standing in front of? Anybody wants to give a quick guess? This is actually the first CT scanner, which is installed in Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. And of course, this bust you will see later. And this lady, she's actually a medical physicist who is actually the director of the clinical CT, Mayo Clinic CT Clinical Innovation Center. And she leads a multidisciplinary team of physicians, scientists, research fellows, and of course, undergraduate students. So this is my building of bridge with all of you. And here is, and next one. So this is Professor Ng, of course, but that's not the clue. The clue is who is, and which year was this photo taken? And who is Willie Callender? Would you like to type the answer? And of course, this is Professor Ng receiving his Marie Sklodowska Award in 2018. Good evening to everybody. Good morning. Crisis. Now, the Chinese characters are really good for definition, or rather the terminology of a crisis. It's made up of two characters, which is weighty. And what it means is the first word wei is actually danger. And the second one, if you use T as in jihui, it means opportunity. So in every danger, there's opportunity. But some scholars say that T itself refers to a special crucial point when something begins or changes. And we find that deep change tends to occur more often in massive crisis. So if you follow what Winston Churchill said a long time ago, he said, never let a good crisis go to waste. How can a crisis be good, right? Or more recently would be Rahm Emanuel, who was the former Chicago mayor. He says, never want a serious crisis to go to waste. So I want you now to type in. Nobody is typing in anything. There's a lag, I'm told, on YouTube. And I have my laptop next to me to see. Now, what do you associate with crisis? Type your answers before I give you how I categorize things that you may associate with a crisis. just type it into the chat box. There's no right or wrong answer. Don't worry. Ah, I see someone from China too. And Colombia. Hi. So, no answers yet. And Mayu will tell me if there is any. I have actually categorized it into three. One is disruption, and nobody likes disruption, whether it's a small personal crisis or a big one like the current pandemic. And then there's also downtime. And finally, I will talk about opportunity. In disruption, you get distressed, you may not be able to sleep, you might get depressed. And more worrying is, of course, economic ruin and loss of lives. And sometimes, of course, there may be danger and you may panic. But crisis also gives you, such as in this pandemic, downtime for which you can rest and relax and think and have space and time. I call it a protected time. For example, if you are sitting in quarantine because you traveled from country A to country B to return to your home, there's a lot more time to reflect. And nobody can ask you to go out or do things for them because you are supposed to be in quarantine. And finally, it has a lot of opportunity because for some people, it is good fortune, right? All the grocery stores are doing so well because they are selling essential goods, whereas retail are not doing so well, but people have to go online. So people have created new ways in which they can find their fortune. Of course, there's advancement depending on whether you want to make use of all those free courses which are online, even from Harvard. And then you make more friends. You are spending time Zooming or Google meeting with maybe friends and family, which you never did because you can't go anywhere if you're in isolation. So we are all in different countries and all in different phases of this pandemic, and everybody has a different lockdown kind of a situation or restriction. But more importantly, it gives us an ability to seize, to change, to revamp, to find new ways of doing things and to connect with friends and family, to go on. If not, otherwise, the new normal will not be better. It will be worse. So do not let the loss of lives in this pandemic go to waste. It's one way of looking at it. Now, does anybody remember the Ebola epidemic in 2014? Did we learn from it? So in a TED talk in 2015, Bill Gates actually talked about the next outbreak. Are we ready? And obviously he highlighted that preparations for the next epidemic has to begin already in 2015, which is from scenario planning to vaccine research, to healthcare worker training. And he actually likened the preparation to as if you're preparing for war. Unfortunately, maybe not enough people heard it because this pandemic is upon us and we are not very, very ready for it at all. So now this crisis management chart you can find anywhere. So I'm not going to go too much about it in definition, understanding nature process, reframing issues and problems by asking the right fundamental questions. But more importantly, I want to highlight to give permission to fail because there are trials and errors to solutions. We need to manage the how and what you say. So the leaders have to rise above discord, disruption, and in fact, disagreement even amongst the people and try to get a buy-in for solutions. They need to lead the perception from within your organization as well as outside, meaning how do you speak to the people so that you balance between causing a scenario of panicking versus people taking it seriously enough. And then my questions are, has our steps taken become worse? The cure that we are trying to do is actually worse than the disease. So what do I mean by that? Are we pushing people into economic ruin? Are we saving lives now, but actually going to cost more lives in the long run? All right, I can see some of fear forced to leave the comfort zone, very good. Some people said they learned from SARS, maybe. If for some countries, definitely, Singapore did, Taiwan did, Hong Kong did, and Malaysia to a certain extent also was able to respond very quickly. Of course, you all know about the medical physics book that Professor Ng and Dr. Madalena has actually edited. It's shipping from March 17, but there's one chapter in the contents which I really was interested in reading and I hope to be able to read it, is that how do you communicate leadership through adversity? Because this is that last part which I say, manage the how and what you say. So let's go into the actual talk today. I use the crisis as a sort of platform for which we are going to launch into how and what and when and who. So these are some of the topics I'm going to go with. And I highlight number 7, which is give back now. And here's Prof. Ng with the, he and his team created the IR thermometer and sensor, and they raised funds, and now he's manufactured and donating it to homes even during this pandemic. So I think some of them would be from his university and his team. I want to share with you when I heard about Ruth Carlos. She is was the president of the American Rongan Ray Society in 2019, and I was there, and I was really privileged to hear her speech. Of course, at that time, she also had slides to make it, but that particular speech of hers about failing up actually spoke to me and caused a light bulb to open. Because when we talk about success, if you have never ever failed and haven't done enough, you will never experience failure, right? But if you say it in that way, it's very difficult to find it to be a positive learning experience. But if you say failing up, it feels so much better to have that particular phrase. So I'm going to tell you that actually the words we use matter a lot. Now, what is success? Let's see what all of you write down. Whatever comes into your mind about success, is it a Ferrari in your garage? Is it a swimming pool in your house? You know, how do you define success? I think to everyone, success means something different, right? Maybe people want to be like Professor Ng Kwan Hong, or you want to be the next Bill Gates. But Jim Carrey, you know, the comedian and actor, what he said was, I think everybody should get rich and famous and do everything they ever dreamed of so that they can find out that it is not the answer. So what he's trying to say is that once you're rich and famous, you do everything that you want to do, it's still not the answer to wherever you want to be. And I think he's referring to peace, contentment, and joy and happiness. Right. So success is just the tip of the iceberg. Okay. Why do I say that? Because when you look at success, actually, the person who is so successful may have been swimming and having to work around the sharks. So that's under the water. And may have dealt with a lot of rejections. Maybe had his work, you know, he was cheated upon. There was a lot of personal sacrifice. Maybe he had to delay family, or maybe he didn't spend enough time with his wife or his family, or vice versa. And there could be a lot of competition. So academic world can be extremely competitive. You are competing for grants. On top of it, you may have personal failure, and of course, a lot of hard work. I want to also say that you need to inculcate some really good habits. If your inner person is, you have integrity and honesty, and you have inner motivation, what motivates you personally from inside, not from outside? You don't need a carrot, you don't need a stick. That helps you to be able to keep going at it until you have your idea of success. And I have a little heart here because I feel that your heart must be in the right place before you can really get to where you want to go, whatever it is. So failure reframe is an opportunity to learn and to practice your coping skills, your strategic skills, and to be able to build resilience. So Dr. Carlos actually mentioned the resilience. For example, how successful a person is probably related to how deep they were when they bounce back. So if you play with your bouncing ball, the harder you hit, the further down it goes, the higher it goes. So it's not an easy way. So usually when you see something very successful, it was not that easy in the first place. So we need to learn how to fail better each time and how to fail up. Right. The next concept I want to tell you is you have to be ready to let go. And actually what I read was, you must be ready to give up. But then give up sounds like, you know, a negative thing. So why not let go, right? Let go and you may free yourself from the positive effects, which is lower your stress, promote your sleep, lessen and get rid of all these psychosomatic problems. We all get shoulder ache, headaches, maybe even constipation or eczema. Persistence is very important. That's how Thomas Edison did the light bulb. But on the other hand, persistence could be a double-edged sword. You might be too focused on a specific plan or promotion that stops you from seeking or noticing opportunities for growth and learning. Because why? If you're too focused, you're very narrow. Just look at this needles highway. And these are really granite formations. And it's only the width of a car going through. And I was standing outside there taking a photo of the car passing through. Because I thought, wow, this, you know, thing of nature was amazing. And it also shows that sometimes we really need to go through really tight areas to come out better. So it's nothing easy, but you also need to know when it's better not to negotiate that. So when you know how to let go, it builds resilience again, you know, that rubber thing, resilience. You can give any other example. I'm just trying to find ways in which you might be able to understand and maybe hit the light bulb in you. It gives you emotional agility and self-awareness. By being able to let go of unrealistic plans and goals, you may be able to go into new territories, which will open up new opportunities for you. Letting go also means sometimes you may have to let go of sitting in your comfort zone. Like today, when I was invited to speak here, it's really not my comfort zone. I had to actually think really hard what I wanted to say. And it is a big responsibility thinking that I need to do something that will be able to help people such as your group and community to go further. And also, I need to tell you, you need to let go of your past glories. So what does that mean? You may have been the valedictorian in school, you may have done very well in university, or you may have done very well in your job, and now you get a promotion. So what does it mean? Whenever you come to a new place, you are actually starting at the bottom because you need to know the culture of your department or the new organization you're working with. You need to learn the ropes, how to handle it. You need to understand how people work there. What are the processes? So you are basically starting from the bottom and trying again to do something like maybe turn around the company, improve, go further, start new projects. The third concept is how do you play to your peak abilities, right? Each of us has different gifts. So success, you can do what you want to do. Yes, that is a good one. Yeah, you want to match your inner purpose and values. For example, what are your personal motivation triggers? In other words, even if I use a carrot and a stick, it's not going to get you to maybe be more productive at work, be more efficient. Because whatever work you are in, it doesn't match with your inner purpose and values. The other thing I want to tell you about is human factors and reliability signs. So what is human factors and reliability signs? I like the simplest of the definitions, which is the study of all factors that make it easier to do work in the right way. So it involves people, processes, systems to facilitate human performance. As we all know, humans are not perfect. Human error, you can only minimize up to a certain amount. You also involves the culture in your department, your environment, how things are implemented, your equipment, everything is the study of human factors and reliability science. And the best concept about this is, and again, I heard this online, is that you make the work fit the person. You don't make the person fit the work. You must make the work fit the person. And by doing so, you reduce error and effort, improve efficiency, lower stress. So I can try to explain this by saying, wear the correct fit shoes. The size of the shoe may be correct, but the design may be not suitable for the shape of your foot. So as you know, at the end of the day, if you're wearing very, very uncomfortable shoes, you're crying on the inside while smiling on the outside, trying to show people that you're fine. You may be showing off a very new pair of shoes, and this happens to women more than men. Okay, so and then you're dying to remove it, or you may be redoing it in your office and wearing slippers. So the part two of this is, so how do we play to our peak abilities? And there is this paper that shows that actually our cognitive functioning peaks at different times. And actually, knowledge, which you have accumulated that is defined as crystallized knowledge, actually comes in your 60s and 70s. So it's never too late to play to your peak abilities. You may be so-called a late bloomer, or you may be an early one. So find a way to recognize and seize opportunities. Practice learning, hey, that's an opportunity. How about this one? I may try this or something. So, and you get a lot of deep change when you have a massive crisis. Maybe you're at a crossroads and you have to decide whether you want to get married to A, B, or C because you are now thinking of your career, right? So is it a crisis? Some people consider it a personal crisis because you're at a personal crossroads. So crisis can be defined in a very wide way. Think it through and stress test it. always have a group of people to talk to. It doesn't always have to be someone older or someone in a position of leadership. It can be your best friend. Always have the male and the female perspective of everything. Run through your ideas or maybe what you feel about where you are right now with as many people as you think necessary. Of course, you have to select the correct people because not everybody. So it would be good if you have a group of people. If you have a problem A, you have this group of people to talk to. If you have a problem at work, you have a different group of people to talk to. And try not to do only what you think you should do. In other words, what you think you should do means that, oh, you know, this is the way things go. Therefore, I should do it this way. No, if you do that, right deep inside you, you can't do it very well because you're nagging at your thought that, oh, this is not what I want to do, but this is what I should do. The other thing you can help yourself is to inculcate curiosity if you're not naturally curious. In other words, it's good if you like to find out why things work. I'm kind of like a semi-geek in the sense that I like to find out why things work, but I may not go all the way into the mini details. But I like to know how things work. It's like, think of a child when they're growing up, the baby. As they are developing, 1, 2 years old, 3 years old, they're very curious. They're asking you why this, why that. So that is the kind of curiousness that helps you to find a lot of interesting things about yourself and maybe find more joy and happiness in what you do, no matter what it is you do. Finally, you have to think about counting the costs. Are you prepared to pay the price? For example, I just told you, between having a family versus your career climbing. And for this, I remember Dr. Reti Chen, whom Professor Ng actually managed to invite to speak to the College of Radiology. And he spoke in 2010, and he said that as a leader and to get up there to be a chair of a department or to head something, number one, you have to lobby a lot of people. And number two, you have to withstand a lot of darts and knives being thrown at you once you are up there. And he says that, you know, it's fine. As long as the knives and darts thrown at you doesn't hit your heart from the front, you carry on living. So that actually also opened my eyes, ears to something and my heart to say, okay, never take anything personally whenever you are out there, but you must be ready to pay the price. I think leadership, sometimes leadership positions are overrated. It is a very lonely position out there. So concept number four, go with the flow, right? Why am I saying go with the flow? Because I'm going to ask you, how many of us, including myself, I can't tell when is the right moment. Opportunities, when they come, may not look like an opportunity, right? You won't recognize it. And then sometimes when some opportunity comes, you don't think you're ready. You don't think you have what it takes, right? But you won't know till you try. Remember, let go of your comfort zone. And you might want to do it in small steps. And please don't stress, because a lot of people say, find your passion and you will definitely follow that passion and you will find success. It doesn't work that way. I know many people, including myself, who didn't know what my passion was. What is my passion? But it's a long process of going around, and then eventually you figure out what clicks in you and what are your inner triggers to achieve a sense of fulfillment, like Ravi says, a sense of fulfillment. So finding the inner value and purpose. Also, don't stress if you're not sure what it is, because not that many people are really good. But I have met very young people at the age of 16, 17, very clear what they want to do when they finish school. They know what course they want to take, and they know how to chart their future. But not everyone is like that. And so it doesn't matter. Go with the flow. Go whatever comes. So one of the examples I'm going to give you is a friend of mine, and I have to change the name and everything. So we'll call her Jenny. So she finished school, and then she applied to university, and she applied to university A, B, and C. One was for chemical engineering, one was for law, and one was for medicine. Does it sound like somebody who really knew what she wanted? No, right? All she wanted was to get a university degree. And then when she made her decision, she was very fortunate. Obviously, her results are very good. She was accepted by all three universities. Then how does she decide between A, B, and C, which university to take? Okay, these three universities, two of them are very well known outside of my country, and one is within my country, Malaysia. And so she decided based on the fact of which of them gave scholarships, right? And never mind. Then how did she narrow it further? Two of them gave scholarships, but only one gave a full scholarship because she didn't want to burden her parents with the payment of her tertiary education. So that was how she made her decision. And then so it landed up with chemical engineering. And then the mother said, you know, there are lots of engineers out there. It must be quite easy. So she went into the course not knowing what to expect. And the phone call came home and she cried. And she says, you know, mom, you said it was going to be easy, but it is so difficult. It is a tough line. But she persevered because she wanted to complete her degree. She's already entered the course. Give it a try. That's what she did. She gave it a try. She graduated. And then she was already headhunted to join a management consultant team. Big name, okay? Big name management consultant team. And after that, she moved on to a big tech company. I won't mention the name, but this is big tech company is where everybody says it's one of the best companies to work for. And everybody looks forward to going to work for this company because of a certain culture within the company. And then before you know it, everybody said, no, how can you just quit this job? No, I want to do a master's of business administration. And she did that. So she quit her job in big tech. And then she went into master's of business administration, completed the course. Then she went and applied for a job, which was an online retail platform. Right now in the pandemic, online retail platform seems to be the way to go, right? But for some reason, she found out it was just not for her. So what did she do? Let go again. So she let go, and then now she's back to another big tech company, and we will see where her flow goes after this. Right, so like I said, when you go with the flow, sometimes you need to do your stress test. You need to find out what matches your peak abilities. So you have trusted people to go to, unleash your curiosity, be aware that there may be many turns and windy roads, and sometimes it's no point playing safe, as Jenny did. She did not play safe, but you are all young. So you can start again. They always say that, you know, you're young, you can take more risks because, you know, you have a longer life ahead. You can build back whatever it is and fail better the next time. However, of course, some of you all may disagree saying that playing safe is important in medicine, and I agree to a certain extent. So when we say no point playing safe, also is within a certain framework. You can't be like anything goes. Point number five, work-life balance. Is there such a thing? And the reason why I want to do this is that, especially for women, and today men also share in the household load, also look after children, right? Is there such a thing? Because I read, and this again gave me a light bulb moment, is that when you work, there's no life. And we are, when you're home or with family or friends, you mean there's no work at all. So how do you define it now today in the pandemic where most of us, if we can do it, not in medicine, not in my profession, I have to work at work, is that you can actually work and live at home in the same place. In fact, family, work and life, everything now is smashed together. And actually, this so-called perfect work-life balance does not exist. So if you find any article that says so-and-so raised a family, very successful, all the children this, and also managed to become a CEO of family, you will find that there were compromises made. Nothing actually comes free. That perfect balance does not exist. And I don't want anyone to feel guilty. So throw these words out of your vocabulary. Just talk about priorities. For example, because I'm a woman, I will talk about family, of course. You find that at certain points in time, your family is more important. You may take a break from work, you know, and then you spend more focus on your family. Then as your children grow older, you go back to work again. And then when your children are older, you will be surprised. You can actually talk to them and negotiate. Okay, I need to attend your basketball game. I may have to attend your concert, but I also have this project to finish. And you have to ask them and make it a shared decision. Right, which is more important for you? Which one should I come? You can lead from any station in life. What do I mean by this? Actually, I'm trying to say that you don't need a title, you know, on your door that says chair of the department, head of the subsection, a chief of something, you know. Why? Because every one of us, when you are young or even now, who has an Instagram, TikTok, Twitter, three of which I don't use, and or Facebook for the older generation. Which of you have it? And how many of you are actually having many followers? By the very fact that you have followers to your YouTube channel, your TikTok, you are actually influencing people. And even if you the most dangerous part is you don't realize that your influence is much greater than you think. So you have to be very careful that you are influencing people for good. And leadership is also about influence. There are many different styles of leadership, of course. But if you can't, you think you don't have any skills, nothing, then do small things in a great way. For example, I give you this, the cleaner who does a job well all the time goes above and beyond, you know, and is demonstrating leadership. He is demonstrating good work ethics. You can give back at any stage. And why do I say that? Give a smile. You will make somebody's day better. That's just as little as that. You don't have to wait to be Bill Gates, Warren Buffett, I'm rich enough, or wait until I retire, I'm free enough, before you can do simple things. For example, when we talk about volunteering, everybody worries about the time commitment. Actually, it is a lot of time commitment because I work very much in breast health as well as palliative care, advocacy. For example, how to improve the quality of dying, right? We can talk about that if you are interested about the quality of dying. The very term itself is something that people are not familiar with. For example, if you walk past a place and it's dirty, you just pick up the rubbish and throw it. What are you doing? You're making the place cleaner for the next person who goes by. You go to a picnic, you pick up all your rubbish so that the next person who comes to this picnic spot has a clean place to do it. What you're doing is you're paying forward. Random acts of kindness will do. You don't need to join organization A, B, or C and volunteer like 10 hours a week or something. All right, so little steps, little things. One of the biggest things you can give back is I'm into carbon footprint. And it's that I found out that the internet is actually has a very, very huge carbon footprint. The data servers, all that use a lot of energy, produces heat and all. So they're actually advising people to unsubscribe for newsletters you don't longer need to receive. You can stop sending unnecessary emails. Don't stream videos. Just stream the music file. And you know, power down your computers when you're done. Instead of leaving it running on safe mode even, we'll use electricity. So buy less, okay, like everybody's like, horrors, but buy less, change your phone less often. Because in the manufacture, the production, and the usage of phone, you use up about 121 liters of petrol and emit 112 kilograms of carbon dioxide a year. So of course, that includes all your base stations and everything. So it's calculated in that way. You can Google it and find it. And so say no to fast fashion, right? So both males and females. And now we realize that since most of us are at home or in isolation or have to work in two teams and we are wearing scrubs at work all the time, do we need so many clothes? No, we don't. But guess what? The retailers are telling you now you need clothes to lounge at home. To work from home, you must be in comfortable clothes. So this marketing is going on to get an opportunity for sales in a different part of fashion. So one of the benefits when you give back at any stage, it boosts your confidence and self-esteem, your sense of purpose. You create meaning in life by finding out what gives you a deep buzz. All right. Now, how do you bridge disciplines anywhere? So what is your understanding of bridging disciplines? Where should you focus on? How do we develop or create a shared goal, such as... This is a very good shared goal. Your heart is in the right place because you want growth and well-being of communities you belong to and the greater world at large. That's why you're a medical physicist, right? So you need to do a bit of hard work before you start on the hard work. And I'm not saying that it's easy. Sometimes you need a little bit of luck to get to where you are. You need a little bit of push from a mentor to tell you, hey, do this. It doesn't even need to be a mentor. It can be just your best friend telling you, go try it. Because it's a greater risk to stay in where you are. So in the healthcare continuum, if you're looking for areas in which you can collaborate, I will tell you that any aspect of care that will help the clinician, the radiologist, the oncologist, who else do you all work with? Lots of people I think you work with any. I think the medical physicist can work with any of the clinicians, is that you can help aid management or you can help in decision-making. To improve the quality of care the patient has. Any aspect of healthcare to make it a safer and higher reliability organization, which is related to human factors and reliability science again. Any aspect of healthcare that improves human well-being for your colleagues, your co-workers, for the staff, the patients, the management, that itself is another area which you can collaborate with, maybe involving design, AI, anything that makes the work more intuitive, that makes you have less failure. Now, as we all know, MRI has lots of safety features, a lot of regulations. You know, we have the beep, 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 beep sound for metal. And yet, you still get accidents. One is in India where the person was killed when he walked in. And then in Sweden, also another accident. Because the metal in the weighted vest completely forgot that there was metal in it. So accidents such as this shouldn't happen. And it's always due to human error. But sometimes, how do you help to reduce human error? And this is the study of human factors and reliability science. Very interesting subject. And I want to end with an example of Naluri, which is a Malaysian startup. And one of the co-founders is actually a medical doctor. And this medical doctor came out of medicine and went into management consultant and was extremely successful at it. And after management consultancy, he then co-founded this startup with his health coach in your pocket. And they have had multi-million dollar US dollars support in the startup. And now it's even coaching more relevant in this pandemic because there's a lot of mental health, physical health. And what is their philosophy? I just want to highlight to you what I told you, your heart must be in the right place for the hard work that you're going to put in, for the good that you're going to bring to your immediate community and the world at large, is they put people first. So we are not doing something new. People who do these programs always have the right heart at the base of it. How do you do things better? Go look it up, the naluri.life. So I have actually used this, and this is my summary slide already, and I have put in this animation to tell you that life is really a roller coaster. And so you need to learn to enjoy it. Choose to be happy, learn to be grateful. You can lead without a major title. You can give back anytime. You let go, you fail up. Please make sure you get the right fit once you are able to. Sometimes we can't help it. We may be in the wrong fit for a while, but let me tell you that every experience you go through, even though it was bad, it will come in useful one day. Go with the flow, whatever comes your way, unless you know where you want to go. For others, go with the flow is fine. Like I said, even job A, job B, every single experience you have comes in useful. Learn to prioritize so that you do not have guilt. It's fine. It's okay. Make sure you have hard work. Examine your heart, your inner motivation, your purpose. There is one school of thought that says that people cannot be motivated. Why? Because we are already pre-motivated. So for a boss to get the best out of their staff, he has to match the work to the staff. Otherwise, he cannot get beyond the efficiency or the work productivity level. In which case, sometimes the boss has to let go of the staff or find a suitable position for the staff to be in so that the staff can excel, right? So that's how, if you have good bosses, they will help you find that fit sometimes. And even if you think you don't have what it takes, you're not ready, please, every small thing you do it to the best of your ability. Do it in a great way. I want to thank you very much for your privilege and your patience. And many countries around the world have beautiful sites. These are some of the sites in Malaysia. So when the pandemic is over, please come and visit us if you have not visited Malaysia. There's plenty. You can do ecotourism or you can be shopping, whichever you want. These are actual photos. Some are from most of them are my own, and two of them are from my friends, one in Taiping, which is a state of Perak, in the Perak state, and one in the Mount Kinabalu Park with the Rafflesia, which is the biggest flower in the world, also the smelliest, in Mount Kinabalu Park, which you can only see. So I'm happy to take any questions, and I see some comments here, which maybe I would like to address.
Dr. Emily Ho, now there are some questions from audience, so I will highlight step by step. So please you answer the question about my highlight.
Okay, how can I judge whether I should give up or not? So many efforts had given and so many things needed to be con. Okay, so this is by trial and error. Give yourself permission to fail. So that comes to my slide on the crisis. Give yourself permission to fail. Did I give up? Okay, this is what happened for me. I was doing very well in my piano lessons, but I did, by the time I was 15, 16, I was already doing the performance diploma. But the performance diploma, I realized that I don't like memorizing scores of music and playing the piano that way, right? But anyway, I went for the exam and I just missed the passing point by just like 1 or 2 points. And much as I love music, I gave that up. I gave up repeating the diploma or just having it just because it looked good on my CV, so to speak, that I can play. But I still contributed to my church for more than 10 years as the pianist for the choir at 8 a.m. I used to go for conferences and say, I must come back by Saturday so that on Sunday I can play for the choir. So you can still make use of your skill that you may have used. I spent many years, my mother also spent many years paying money for my piano lessons, but I've given it up in that sense that I do not pursue. I can't play, I can't be like Condoleezza Price and go and rise and play a piece of concert, a concert piece for people to hear. You know, I can't do that. But did I waste all that money and that time? No, I don't think I did so. Yeah, it sounds kind of small. And I have to admit that sometimes when you're in a job and the job is paying all your bills, it is very difficult to give it up. So this is where I also went through this situation of, hey, should I change my job place? Maybe I should be where I can earn more money, right? So then I talked to a few people. And one of the things they said is, what you need to do is sit down and do a risk analysis. Is it riskier to stay or is it riskier to go? Which is more risky? So the same here for you is, should you give up or not or let go? You decide. Which is the better one? Which gives you more benefits, more pros and cons? That's one way in which you can do it. And don't forget, give yourself allowance. If you made the wrong decision, it's fine. You will still find a way to, did I stumble? I do a lot of breast health advocacy. How did I stumble upon it? I didn't know I was interested in doing a lot of public education. I didn't. And how did I stumble upon palliative medicine? And because, again, I stumbled upon it because I was doing breast health advocacy. Why are people suffering when they die? They don't have to suffer when they die. That's the whole point of improving the quality of dying in palliative medicine. And then the other one was, how did I suddenly get inspired to want to educate women about how to do self-breast exam? Because I kept doing ultrasounds of the for patient, and when they lie down for some reason, they will speak. They will tell you that they are afraid because of what they feel in their breast, even though it's the normal texture. And that all those campaigns outside telling you that, you know, feel your breast, look at your breast, you know, in 4 steps, it's very easy, all those campaigns. It actually doesn't work. Because I have so many women who say that when they feel their breast, it is always confusing them until they dare not feel it anymore. So, which is counterproductive. Any principle leads to the priority. Is everyone the priority different? Okay, everyone's priority, yes, is different. Let me tell you some stories again, right? So, when I was young, I always thought I wanted to be an astronaut. You know, you have these fantastic dreams, right? And then after you go through school, you find out, maybe I don't want to do all these things. How did I land up in medicine? Not because I chose it. Because my parents only give me 3. Being Asian, we only have in the old days, you know. Today, when I never tell people now, you need to be in A, B, or C because of job security. Because as you know, job security today, one day this job is useful, the next day is no longer in fashion. So you have to keep reinventing yourself. So if for you, an important thing is to raise a family, if success to you is raising a family, then of course, finding a partner and getting married is important. And if that is so important to you when you get married, I have friends who have given up after years of studying medicine, they are full-time mothers, unbelievable, right? So I also have friends who have done, what else have they done? Well, most of them have just given up whatever they learned just to become homemakers. and they never went back to work. And then I have another one who went back to work in her late 40s, which was not easy because she has been, she has stopped working for so long. Okay, so that's one way. Two, like I said, if you know having that Ferrari is important for you and for you is happiness, then number one, I would ask you to re-examine how important are material things in your life. The pandemic has shown us that all these are to not, you have a Ferrari sitting at home because you can't drive it anywhere if you have movement control order as in Malaysia. If you are in a country where they allow you to move around freely, then of course that doesn't apply. This is another one which many people have is all your designer handbags. Where are you taking it to when you're really at home? And I've even friends have gone into plastic. Why? Because they can't sanitize their designer leather handbag. It will destroy their leather, right? So what are material things to you? I'm not sure whether I'm answering your question, so please type it if you need further clarification. I think your priority is always as in, you know, number one is, can you make enough money or find a job where you can live? And number two, how to be financially free. So now again, then what is richness? What is enough money? Again, differs from person to person. So if you can learn to live more simply and have less, then you don't have to earn so much money, right? So if you want to buy a Ferrari, you may be buying it on installment. I mean, we are not Bill Gates and we are not Warren Buffett. And Warren Buffett actually drives a very simple car and only takes a very low pay. So different people, different. Even if you look at Bill Gates, his house is relatively modest compared to the amount of money he has, right? And some of these people who are very rich are actually in debt. That's why I said, you are looking at the tip of the iceberg. I always look down, there may be a shark down there. Or there may be a lot of other things like debt. Okay, so these are some of the things. And one of the dangerous things we do is we put ourselves into a comparison trap. One of the very good things I learned growing up from my mother, actually, is that do not compare yourself with the person beside you, with your neighbor, with your classmate. Compare yourself with yourself. Do better for yourself. Every incremental benefit and improvement you get is compared to your baseline. Every improvement. So that is how you compare with yourself and improve yourself. If you get into a comparison trap, there will be always somebody better than you. And we tend to compare upwards. We never compare downwards. That means we never look at who is worse than us, but we look at who is always better than us. Why can't I have better hair? Why do I have frizzy hair? A simple thing like that. Why can't I have fairer skin? Another person said, why can't I have darker skin so that I look, I have a permanent tan, right? So beauty, again, is very different from everybody else. Okay. What's your opinion about living in the present is part of going with the flow, right? So if you ask me, I actually find the pandemic in a way good because when you're forced to wear your mask, you actually get less coughs and colds. And you're a little bit more concerned about, well, in medicine, we have to sanitize our keyboards, which I think very important because I found that the keyboards is ickier than your toilet. The amount of germs, especially if it's a shared keyboard at work, right? Your computer keyboard, it's not only you owning it, unless you have your own office and you are in charge of something and that computer nobody else touches, then at least it's only your own germs, right? But otherwise, these are some of the things you can do. Living in the present is very, very important. Appreciating the fact that we are here, we have this opportunity to be in a webinar, we are better off than so many other people in the whole wide world, right? But being better doesn't mean you gloat and say, haha, that person, you know, I'm so much better. No, don't do that because at the end of the day, always be grateful and always appreciate what you have, be thankful. For example, I'm very thankful to Professor Ng because of his pushing and telling me, do this, you can do it. And then I go ahead and think that, yeah, maybe I can, but I'm not ready. I have a lot of, I don't have the skills, I don't have the time, I don't have the support, you know. But in the end, I did it. It was not easy. Once you are higher up in position, people do a lot of things. Sometimes you're doing it for the correct reason, but people can't see it. And then there's a lot of chatter behind you. And one thing you do is you learn to rise above all this. And one of the things we all learn is to go not take anything personally. It's not about you when people get upset with you. I actually started up a small department, and there were a lot of some letters that went about. And then sometimes some of the letters are quite opposite of what you are doing. But after a while, the person I spoke to says, hey, this is nothing. You should see what we get in the bigger hospital. You know, I said, really? You know, so we learn along the way, and then you learn not to take things personally. I think that is one of the biggest lessons. I mean, now that I'm this age, I've learned not to take things personally, and I just do the best that I can. And I've always had this credo that the best thing you do is to do the best that you can. If you're living in the present now, do the best that you can. If you can be kind to people now, and it's so important to be kind to people right now in the pandemic, do it, because that is your paying forward and you're doing good. You don't need to be rich. You don't need to spend any money, you know, but just be kind. You know, being kind is so important. So maybe it's good time for us to reflect on what are the good things that we should be doing. I really feel that if in your heart you want to do good, sooner or later you will be recognized, because you're consistently doing it. Your actions tell people what and who you are, and people take the time to know you. I think that's why I said that, you know, a cleaner who does his work very well, people will notice his work ethics. And this is how you get promoted, you know, maybe become supervisor. That's how it works. But of course, you need a little bit of luck to be in the right place at the right time. Everybody who got rich, if some of my friends are really rich, you know, the whole car, the whole garage is full of expensive cars. Am I jealous? No. I'm so happy that they have what they have. Because at the end of the day, I don't want to look after cars. It's just too much work. You know, one service in the, you take the car for servicing, is maybe more than your month's pay. And I really don't want to think about that. But, you know, they told us that, oh, I had a bit of luck when the investment made a lot of money for them. They had a little bit of luck, and it's not like it's all that they did it themselves. So I'm not sure whether it's living in the present is, that's your question, but if not, can ask more. I'm only too happy to talk about it. If only y'all could sometimes speak, but StreamYard doesn't allow. Actually, I want to hear about what it is like in South America. And then someone here said that, yes, opportunities can come disguised as hard work. Definitely. And that hard work gives you extra skills. Do something new, do something different, take up the challenge. Because that extra skill will come in anywhere. It can be in your home life. It doesn't have to be only in your workplace.
Okay. One more question here.
Uh-huh. Okay. Will go with the flow conflict with make the world fit you? No, I'm not asking you to make the world fit you. When I say make the work fit you, that is in relation to your areas of research, development, and creativity. Read about human factor and reliability science. It is the science of how to make the workplace, including the culture of your workplace, better for human being performance, so that they do not have obstacles and they do not make as many mistakes. Now, all of us are human. We all make errors. Okay? There is no way to minimize your error to zero. Impossible. So how do we minimize you making that error? So that is the one. So the world can't fit you. You need to find your fit in the big world. But the work that you go into research in, for example, you can maybe, some of you may be into AI, machine learning. You're figuring out some tools, right? You're helping the doctors make better decisions by not having to click about 10 different pages before I get to where I want to go. By doing that, you are helping people improve. So if that is what you like to do, then that work is good fit for you. And sometimes the reason why you go with the flow is because by hitting A, you go to B, and then finally you hit someone that says, hey, this is what I want to do. That is one way in which there's the other group of people who know exactly what they want to do because they're very in tune with themselves. Then they know exactly where they want to go and they try to look for that. But like I said, when you try to look for that, you cannot keep yourself so narrow that opportunity coming beside you, you didn't notice it because you're looking here. You're looking for promotion in company A, but company B just came with an interesting option which could have made your so-called success higher or bigger, depending on what you're looking at it. So I'm not sure what you mean by you should continue giving up. Are you in your right line of work? Is that what I understand? It's okay to change your line of work. Banks like to hire engineers because they have learned how to be analytical and logical in thinking. And banks, it's not the first one. Every time I ask my patient, so what line are you in? Banking. Oh, what kind of thing did you do? Business, account? No. I was an engineer, structural engineer, mechanical engineer, anything you name it. I say, your bank likes all this. Yes. The bank likes it because they like that training. So what does it mean? That whatever you're doing, right, has got some skill that is taught to you or that you learn. And that's how people make use of it. So like the doctor in management consultant, not as a doctor. He trained as a doctor, but he's a management consultant. Professor Ng Guang Hong says, why is he wasting time with the mentoring program? Yes, definitely. I think the mentoring program is very good. Because like I said, I ask all of you to find some trusted people who can be your best friend, who can be someone at work, could be an old teacher, could be your parents. There's nothing wrong with your parents because some parents are really good at being mentors for you. If you can find people at work, good. Find people at play. Why do I say that? Because you need different perspectives. So Prof. Ng is one of those who I think has a big vision. And this mentoring program is to give you different aspects. Why? Because I already said not all of us, including myself, knew my passion. Like I said, I was given three options. And just because the first thing you do is you do very well in school, so you have many options. Okay, then when you have many options, it's actually bad, right? When you go to a car park and you only have one car park slot, you immediately go to that car park slot, right? What happens when you go to a car park when there are many slots? Maybe I should park here. Oh no, I think I should park closer to the building. And you will keep going until you don't even know which one to go into, right? Too many choices sometimes can be difficult. Definitely, I agree with Professor Ng.
So anyone have any
what about comments? Any comments? Yeah. Okay, we are 1 hour already.
Yes. So maybe we can stop here.
Yeah, I'm happy with that as long as everybody is happy. Does Professor have any other words of wisdom here?
Yeah, actually a lot of audience.
I want to thank Professor Ng for introducing Dr. Reti Chem, who came to speak. I think he has done this throughout his life. Consistently, he tries to bring people in if they are passing through. He's forgotten it already, but I just reminded him in 2010 because I started the website for the College of Radiology, and I was both the photographer, the writer, the editor. I did everything. And so what you do by doing that is, I think a lot of people say, why are you wasting all your time on this? But I got one feedback from somebody who is senior, who is outside of Kuala Lumpur. He says, if I want to know what's happening with the College of Radiology, I'll go to the website. By the next day, I know you would have written something about it. So all you need is just one little tiny feedback like that, then you know you're on the right track. And if it creates a buzz in you, then you're on the right track. Little things like this. But then there's always a time to move on, right? Like now, we will move on so that everybody can either get back to work. Thank you very much, I must say, to everybody. I hope there's some things that you can take back. Maybe not everything applies to you, but it's food for thought. And I've given you some of the website links. Please go look it out, The Barefoot Leader. Read a lot because it really helps you to open your mind.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Ho, again. It's a really excellent speaking. I learned a lot from you. So thank you all, audience. So now I close the section. See you next month. Bye.
Bye, everybody.